King Nebuchadnezzar plans to build the most magnificent tower ever seen. He wants its blue summit to dominate the horizon. But that gives the king a problem.
Looking around at the landscape, lots of greens, lots of browns, but no blue. So the question is, how did the ancient Babylonians get such brilliant blue glazes?
The Ishtar Gate in ancient Babylon may hold a clue. This is a reduced scale reproduction. It's part of the building work ordered by the former Iraqi dictator Saddam Hussein in the 1990s.
This is a reduced reproduction of one of the Ishtar Gates. Fragments of the original were excavated in the early 1900s, moved and rebuilt in a Berlin museum. There are similarities to the description of the structure on top of the ziggurat, including its color.
Archaeologist Zahed Taj Eddin investigates what makes the tower so blue. Zahed specializes in the glazes on ancient artifacts and tiles. He begins by examining Nebuchadnezzar's own description of the tower, found on a tablet in Babylon.
I built it, Menaki, the ziggurat of Babylon, and brought it to completion and raised high its top with the pure tile, glazed with lapis lazuli. So, lapis lazuli, here it is.
Lapis lazuli is a semi-precious stone. Its intense blue color makes it prized across the ancient world. It's mentioned several times in the Bible. Zahed investigates how the king can possibly cover the top of the tower with a semi-precious stone. He makes a glaze by mixing lapis lazuli with a natural glue called gum arabic.
Now, the lapis lazuli powder is fixed with gum arabic, and it's kind of like semi-permanent. So they would use it on decorating maybe frescoes or later in decorating manuscripts.
But this glaze also needs to be weatherproof.
They might thought if they put it in the kiln, they might have like a permanent result, and then they can use it on the bricks.
To fix the glaze, Zahed bakes the tile in his kiln.
Here it is after firing. It's no longer beautiful and blue and dazzling. So, yeah, it's failure.
The vivid blue glaze has disappeared. Yet Nebuchadnezzar says he uses tiles of lapis lazuli on his tower. Zahed thinks he knows how he does it. It starts with the art of glassmaking.
They already were experimenting with the glass, which is silica pebbles. If you grind it and heat it, you need about 1,700 degrees for it to melt.
Craftsmen make glass by heating silica, which comes from sand or rocks, until it melts. Liquid glass can also be used to produce shiny glazes for pottery.
Nebuchadnezzar now has a new challenge for his workmen. He wanted lapis lazuli color.
To create different colored glazes, they add minerals to the ground up silica pebbles. Zahed paints on a glaze containing two minerals readily available to the ancient Babylonians. Copper oxide, which looks dark green, and blue cobalt.
So here we are, the moment of truth. Lapis lazuli blue. So that addition transformed the glaze into this kind of deep blue. And now we know why in ancient Mesopotamia they would refer to this bricks as lapis lazuli.
The Tower of Babel's builders create an ingenious way to cheaply mimic the blue color of lapis lazuli.
And that was great alchemy, great secret. All of the sudden have this glass that substitute semi-precious stones right at hand.
There's a puzzle left behind in Nebuchadnezzar's description. The ancient Babylonians see no distinction between the semi-precious stone and the one that they can manufacture for themselves.
In ancient Mesopotamia, they have two names for lapis. Uknu Shashadu, which means lapis from the mountain, and Uknu Shakuri, and that's lapis lazuli from the kiln. Sometimes in the literature, they don't even specify anymore if it's from the mountain or if it's at the kiln.
King Nebuchadnezzar's lapis lazuli is man-made. The tower is not meant to be covered in precious stones, but it is meant to be spectacular.
It's such a statement, it's such a legacy. It's there to stay and still impress us today.
And the striking color it creates gives a clue to the purpose of the tower. The Babylonians worship the god Marduk. He wears an elaborate horned crown of gold and lapis lazuli. Marduk's shrines and temples throughout Babylon are decorated lavishly with the rich blue color. And the city's processional way is clad in lapis blue, ready for the annual New Year parade they hold in Marduk's honor.
The tower was a shrine dedicated to the god Marduk. The sides most likely were decorated with dragons. This was Marduk's sacred animal.
The immense tower is built to honor the Babylonians' god. But why does the Bible claim the tower is so tall it reaches the heavens? Medieval paintings show the summit of the tower shrouded in clouds.
This is a typical depiction of the Tower of Babel. The one thing they all have in common is a structure that reached into the clouds.
But does the tower really stretch that high? Or is this an exaggeration made by the enslaved Jews of Babylon who write the Bible story? Jeff once again turns to his eye in the sky.
Up it goes!
They take the drone up to an altitude of 300 feet, the same height as the top of the tower. It allows Jeff to imagine what Babylonians standing on its summit could once see. The spectacular city stretches out beneath. But the tower is a long way from reaching the clouds. Jeff thinks he has a more likely explanation for the tower's fabled mist-covered pinnacle.
Excavations, when they were done here previously, they could not go lower than a few meters because of the high water table. Babylon, of course, is next to the river.
Evidence of an ancient bridge on this spot shows that the Euphrates once took a different course than today.
So, we're standing right now on the south side of the ziggurat. Now, if we're standing here, we know that over there was Isagala Temple. And between the two ran a very important road. And that went right through here. And just behind here was the river, the Euphrates. And there they built a bridge. Now, the interesting thing was is that when the archaeologists over 100 years ago were here excavating, they went to the site and they found the original bridge structure. So the bricks that supported piers, that the bridge rested upon.
over time, the Euphrates has changed course. And 2,500 years ago, the river runs close to the tower.
Historically, it was much closer, so the tower would have stood there, right next to the river.
A few hundred miles from Babylon, there are vast mountain ranges with snow-capped peaks which help to feed the nearby rivers. In the spring, the mountain snow melts, swelling the Euphrates and Tigris rivers and flooding Babylon in the plains below.
It meant that in the spring, the ground surrounding the ziggurat was more waterlogged than it is today. And after a cold desert night, the morning sun would heat the ground, creating this kind of mist.
The Babylon ziggurat, right next to the river, is engulfed in this mist, as if it's touching the clouds.
We know that the same effect exists at other places. For example, the Taj Mahal. But at Babylon, imagine a 300-foot tower surrounded by a sea of clouds, a mist, and resting on top of it, this brilliant blue shrine. Must have been amazing.
This atmospheric phenomenon may explain why the tower is believed to touch the heavens. But according to ancient Jewish texts, God is so angered by this ambitious project that he sends a great wind and destroys it. Today, investigators piece together the true fate of the tower. Babylon is conquered by the Persians after Nebuchadnezzar's death. They prohibit the worship of the god Marduk and smash a hole in the tower. The Greek king Alexander the Great captures Babylon from the Persians and tears down the damaged tower with plans to rebuild it. But in 323 BC, Alexander dies, leaving the Tower of Babel as a pile of bricks, ripe for looting over the coming millennia. Centuries of war keep Babylon in ruins, until Saddam Hussein builds a palace on the site. Today, Jeff and the World Monuments Fund work with local conservationists to safeguard the once magnificent city of Babylon for future generations.
It is of immense significance and important to us that we've been asked to participate with our Iraqi friends in preserving their history. Not just for the people of Iraq to only see, but for the whole world to experience their great accomplishments.
The Tower of Babel is an extraordinary triumph of engineering. Using just mud, straw, and bitumen, the Babylonians build a tower more magnificent than any seen before. Shining a brilliant blue, it soars into the skies. A spectacular monument to human ingenuity.